tonight. How green is your garden centre?
People in the UK, they love their gardens, and they'd be devastated if they knew that this was what was happening.
We reveal some deep-rooted problems.
None of these are native species at all. These have all come in from overseas.
Are our garden centres cutting corners when it comes to the environment?
I had a look to see just what plastic I had. I thought, right, I'll get rid of some of these. I've been to garden centres and nurseries, and none of them want them.
Good evening and welcome to the Tonight programme. If you've been pottering around in the garden this summer, then you are not alone. It is a national pastime worth billions of pounds. Every week, thousands of us head to our local garden centre. But just how green are they? From plastic pots to peat compost, Chris Choi has been digging around and has some surprising revelations in the trouble with garden centres.
Britain is blooming and garden centres are booming. From humble beginnings, they've blossomed into a £6 billion sector. And if one of the things you're interested in growing is profits, this is the perfect industry. No longer just horticultural, they've expanded into catering, gifts and merchandising.
Yeah, the garden centre market's in quite a robust place at the moment. It's diversified in the last 10 years. We've got really good restaurants, we've got gift departments.
The garden centre industry has been growing by about 3% a year over the last 5 years, and we're projecting similar growth up to 2024, when it will reach £7.5 billion.
There is a lot to love about these places, but we have an important environmental question. How green are garden centres? And we start with peat, which so many of them sell. For most gardeners, peat is a versatile natural ingredient found in the compost we buy. Every year, we use enough in our gardens to fill 23 Albert Halls. And to find out why gardeners love it so much, we've come to an allotment in North Yorkshire, where peat is aplenty.
What are you using these peat products for?
So the potatoes, Brussels sprouts, red cabbage, broccoli, the cauliflowers. I think even when I transplanted my rhubarb further down.
It's good for getting them going, rather than filling the tubs with soil from the garden and just fill it with peat.
And when you have used peat, what kind of results have you had?
Oh, I also get good results, yeah.
But there's a problem with peat, and I've come to the middle of Ireland to show you. They call it the Emerald Isle, but here you'll find brown, barren earth. These vast scars across the green landscape are caused by the harvesting of peat. A unique natural habitat is being shattered by machines on an industrial scale. This is how huge demand from UK garden centres is being met.
We've been given very unusual access to get this close to the peat production process, and the workers here tell me that this will be bagged up and end up in UK garden centres. And as you can see, what's left when they've taken it away looks pretty barren. It doesn't look like it could sustain much wildlife at all.
As mechanical diggers rip the peat from this ground, a treasured ecosystem is devastated. This is what a peat bog should look like. They take an incredibly long time to form, a year to grow just a millimeter.
It is surprising just how green the bog is when, like this, it's unspoilt. There's moss and plant life. There are birds around here. This is real diversity, but of course, this is becoming very rare.
Wildlife charities believe peat belongs in bogs, not bags. They say when this landscape goes, so do the birds, one species in particular.
And it's an incredibly important habitat for breeding curlew. They've suffered about a 97% decline since the 1980s. And there's currently only about 135 breeding pairs left in the country, in the Republic of Ireland. If we do nothing, you're looking at possible extinction within about the next 10 years.
Alongside this large-scale loss of natural habitat, there is an invisible impact. Peatlands store carbon dioxide. Tearing them apart like this releases greenhouse gases. Catherine O'Connell has been warning about the climate change consequences for years.
In my mind, I always think garden people in the UK, they love their gardens, and they'd be devastated if they knew that this was what was happening and that they were actually augmenting this process. They were providing a market for this type of activity in Ireland. For me, this is a total disaster area because it's a brown desert. As you can see, there's absolutely nothing living out there. Look at the peat, it just blows away. And of course, the biodiversity is gone. You can forget about that.
But despite all those years of environmental concern, the digging goes on, and UK garden centres are the biggest customers. How will our gardeners react when they see, for the first time, where their peat is from? Back to the allotments in Yorkshire.
It just looks absolutely shocking. It looks like rubble. It looks as if someone's gone through a city and just bulldozed it.
It's devastating. Just take it for granted, don't you? Buy compost, you don't realise.
It's industrial vandalism, is that? I'd like to know what are they putting in its place after they've dug it up.
Peat producers say they operate under licence, complying with environmental legislation. Although the bogs can't always be restored, they can be rehabilitated.
I won't be buying it again. I'll make do with planting it into soil.
This is on our own doorstep, isn't it? I'm just wondering why this doesn't have a higher profile, really, if I'm totally honest.
In the future, will you be now using less peat?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's unbelievable.
This stuff is natural and organic, but it's taken just a few photos showing how it's harvested to make these gardeners determined to find alternatives to peat.
Major peat producers say they won't open new bogs and that some alternative composts have environmental impact because they're imported, meaning air miles. For years, the industry has had a voluntary agreement with the UK government to phase out peat sold to amateur gardeners by 2020. Yet tons is still being sold. I'm on the road, visiting 10 garden centres, looking at what information peat buyers get. Our research shows that all too often, the labelling of peat is unclear. Frequently, there's no mention at all on the front of pack, and elsewhere, you'll often find just vague approximations. Ian, do you think the labelling of these peat products is up to scratch?
You look at how complicated it is for a start.
Ian Rotherham is a sort of professor of peat. He thinks more information on the packs would mean fewer buyers, especially if it pulls no punches.
I think the first thing is that on the front, a bit like you get on a cigarette packet, it should say environmental warning and it should be compulsory, it should be in big letters, it should be obvious, so that you then have a choice and you can walk away with this and you know what you're doing.
A lot of the packaging mentions peat and tries to give some idea of the proportion of peat to alternative material. But it's often lacking clarity,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
Just the scales that they're using and the graphics. There are no industry-wide rules on how information is laid out on labels, so different companies use different terms. For some, reduced peat can still have up to 90% of the stuff.
low peat apparently is 40 to 60%. I don't see how that is low. Reduced peat is 60 to 90%.
And some products that contain it don't mention peat at all. But the manufacturers of these products say they comply with all labelling regulations, giving customers clear, accurate information. They reject the idea of a warning on packs as inappropriate. Despite all the environmental evidence, not one of the big garden centre chains has yet gone completely peat-free. And they now have just months before that voluntary deadline to end sales by next year.
You're not making very rapid progress. Do you agree that you'll miss that target?
I think, in all honesty, that the 2020 target will be very difficult to reach. I think in terms of total peat content in growing media, then what we have achieved is a reduction to 56%. What is critical here is that we look at alternatives that are genuinely sustainable.
Why isn't the industry more clear and open in its labelling of peat?
I think we need to make strides there to make that clear. What we are hoping to launch later this year is a responsible sourcing scheme that will use a number of different environmental criteria to inform the consumer of what is in the bag of growing media that they're purchasing.
But most of the peat that I saw being removed in Southern Ireland is coming, they tell me, to UK garden centres, so you can't detach yourself from what we saw there.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. And I think if we have a zero peat ambition, then whether that peat is produced in Ireland, whether it's produced in Poland, then zero peat means zero peat.
The UK government told us they are working with the horticultural sector to overcome the barriers to going peat-free. They say gardeners can play their part by switching to peat alternatives. For now, garden centres will keep selling peat, but we don't have to keep using it. And for those who want to use alternative composts or mulches, here are some tips from professional gardener Danny Clark.
So what can you use instead of peat? Here in front of me, I've got some great alternatives. Peat-free compost containing fine bark, wood fibre and coir. Composted fine bark, a great soil conditioner. Bark nuggets, which will decompose over time. Manure, adds nutrients and organic matter to the soil. Sheepswool, great for water retention in your pots and containers. And leaf mould bags. Now, you can put your leaves in this, and over time, they will decompose along with a bag. A great soil improver. And above all, get your own compost maker and make your own compost.
Back at the Yorkshire allotments, they say peat should be kept where it belongs, in the ground, not in their gardens. So, how are they doing?
It's been a pretty successful 4 weeks. I've used the peat-free stuff and everything seems to be growing absolutely fine. So, I'm converted. Here's my red and white onions, which I planted straight into the soil. No compost at all.
This is alpaca poo, but we've also got homemade compost. We use grass clippings, horse manure.
Well, I've stopped growing in peat. I've started growing it just in garden soil to begin with. I've had various success. Some have grown, some haven't, but I'm going to persevere.
The industry plans to improve peat alternatives, and some gardeners say they have a long way to go.
It just doesn't work. There's too much stuff in the peat-free. I mean, I've had bits of wire, bamboo cane, shredded wood, all shredded in this compost.
But peat isn't the only environmental issue facing our garden centres. There's one that stands out in every outlet I visited, plastic. There are an estimated 500 million plastic plant pots produced every year for the UK market. And there's plenty here on the allotment with our gardeners.
Are you surprised at the amount of plastic that's on sale in garden centres?
I think everywhere you look, there's plastic for sale. You're buying compost, it's in a plastic bag. If you're buying a plant in a plastic container, we're trying to use less of the black plastic because that's obviously very difficult to recycle. The local recycling centres, they can't pass it through the machines.
We surveyed 100 garden centres across the country and 78% did not offer either a recycling or exchange scheme for their plastic pots. And one colour extensively used in UK garden centres emerges as the biggest problem. Black pots are a nightmare to reprocess. We followed the trail of where many of them end up, and recycling plants like this just can't handle them.
We identify plastic by shining light on it, and depending on how it reflects, we can see it and we can detect what type of plastic it is. With black, it doesn't reflect light, so it goes under the machine and we miss it.
And that's one reason why 87% of councils won't recycle these black pots. Here, they're working on a solution, but it relies on manufacturers changing how they make plastic pots.
I think the first thing is people can reuse pots. They can take them back. They can use them again at home. Manufacturers can change the design of the pots, maybe label them so people know if they're detectable black or not, so people will know if to put them in their household recycling bin.
So what's the industry doing about these piles of plastic?
Why haven't all garden centres got a recycling scheme to help with this problem?
I think some garden centres can find it difficult just in terms of volume. I think there can be a biosecurity issue if they don't know where that soil and that plant pot's coming from. That's been a restriction.
The industry's solution is to change pots to a colour recycling machines can handle. It's this grey, or as they call it, taupe shade.
What we've done as an industry, and we've launched that this year, is to produce a plastic pot that is different in colour. So it is made from recycled material itself, and it can be recycled, and it can be recycled curbside. Our challenge is to get local authorities to recognise that the taupe pot is a genuine recyclable product. And then customers can feel confident that they can get their plastic recycled.
So, what can you buy instead of black plastic pots? Here's Danny again.
Coir plots, just stick them in the ground and they will decompose over time. This seed tray is made from 100% recycled paper. Why not pop seeds in some newspaper pots? Look at your household waste. Loo rolls, egg cartons, great for seedlings.
Back at the allotments, have they managed to ditch the plastic?
And I've tried three different things. The first one was in old tin cans, and then into used toilet roll. And then we got a little device for making pots out of newspaper.
I've perhaps not tried hard enough in the past. I will be making every endeavour to make better use of the plastic that I've got.
I'd have looked to see just what plastic I had. I've been to garden centres and nurseries, and none of them want them because they're frightened of any disease contamination. I said, well, look, I wash them and they're disinfected. No, sorry, we won't take them.
The chain garden centres, I've not had any success. And we found a local garden centre. She lets you return plastic pots. And she said that she would then be able to use those for her next projects.
Of course, garden centres pride themselves on their specialist knowledge, but some people say they're not passing on enough information on plant labels. And that can mean that there's more in the pot than you expected.
Millions of garden centre plants are imported. Many don't state country of origin on the label, but when they come in from overseas, they sometimes carry unwelcome stowaways.
A couple of years ago, we had this giant Egyptian grasshopper turn up in Tayside in a garden centre. So even the things that are living on the plants are still sneaking in. It's enormous.
And that's far from a one-off. Research for this programme has exposed other alien invaders in our garden centre pots.
These two here is an Australian flatworm, and they were bought in a garden centre in the New Forest. You can see this one here in the bottom of a pot plant. We're importing £1 billion worth of pot plants into the UK every year. I mean, that is tons and tons and tons of soil that's coming in that could have all sorts of things in it, and clearly does. Increasingly, people are realising that this invasive species issue is damaging our future ability to grow trees, to feed ourselves, to have healthy gardens, and to have a healthy, robust ecosystem.
I want to show you this. It's a pot plant from the garden we're in now. And I noticed something a bit suspicious underneath. What do you think?
Oh, yeah, yeah. None of these are native species at all. These have all come in from overseas. Here we've got the Balkan three-line slug, and here's the green-spotted slug. And people will be getting these in their gardens. This one in particular also goes into houses.
It really is an invasion.
Yeah.
I think I'll put it down quickly.
For our survey, we took lavender as an example. We went to 20 garden centres and found that one in five of those plants had no information on where they were grown at all. And there's other information missing too. You often don't get told whether peat and pesticides were used to grow these plants, information many gardeners would find useful.
I think it's really hard for consumers to know what they're buying when they go to a garden centre. We're worried about those imports because they can bring with them insects or fungus or other pests and diseases which could then spread into the wild.
The garden centre industry recognises more should be done and big changes are coming.
From the middle of December this year, every plant that is sold in the United Kingdom will effectively have to have a passport that gives a whole lot of information about where that is sourced, the customer would be able to see. But more importantly, it allows the industry full traceability of its products.
Do you accept that by importing so many plants, that there is that risk of also bringing in the foreign pests, the foreign diseases?
There will be another scheme, a plant health assurance scheme, that will be launched this next spring, spring 2020, by which all producers of plants will have to comply if their product is going to be accepted by retailers.
For the time being, Danny has one easy alternative for gardeners.
If you're worried about invasive species and where your plants are coming from, why not buy UK-grown plants? All you need to do is look for Union Jack on the label and you'll know it's grown here.
It's been a year of glorious growing, and along with the plants, some powerful ideas have taken root. Now, they're set to change things far beyond our gardens.
I think the garden centre industry has woken up really recently to the whole ethical argument around consumerism and is definitely acting.
22% of gardeners say that they will choose their retailer based on eco factors. And we found that retailers are responding very strongly to this trend.
They are the businesses that will help millions of us relax this summer. But the industry won't be putting its feet up. There's still too much to do as it aims to bring us far greener garden centres in future.
If you'd like any more information about tonight's programme, just head to our website at itv.com/tonight. Until next time, good evening and thanks for watching.
Coming up next week, do our elderly have the right type of housing?
It's hard because I'm not very steady on my feet. Well, when you've been a busy lady and then suddenly you don't do anything and you're trapped inside, that is not a good feeling, really. Not good feeling at all.
The Irish Toad Surf Rescue Club assist Ireland's champion surfer in new rescue River Deep Mountain High tomorrow night at 8. Next tonight here on ITV, we're back in the Dales and Tracy is in denial as Emmerdale continues after the break.